You're on the Virtual Entertainment Programming Network. TVEPN.com. TVEPN Studios, The Slam Show. And now, your host, Slam.
What's up? What's shaking, everyone? I actually took that from Mr. T from KNBR. He always says that.
What's shaking?
Yeah. Wouldn't you like to know?
Welcome, everyone, to another edition of The Slam Show for June 8th, 2015. I am the captain of this ship. Even though we're down one person, we're going to still keep on rolling. And that one person is Arlene Barshinger. And
feel better soon.
Exactly.
Stay cool.
She fell victim to the overwhelming heat that we're having today. And yes, heat stroke is a very big thing, and she is working through it at this time, so she's unable to be next to Joe time here in the studio rubbing his leg.
You gotta rub your own leg.
Wouldn't be the first.
Or we should have just got a picture of her and at least imagine.
A little cardboard stand up, little prop.
Exactly. I don't think he wants Iron Man.
That'd be fun if we did have like a bunch
Who
of
doesn't want Iron
cutouts
Man?
Of ourselves.
For when we're not here.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, there you go.
That's a good idea.
Put a little spring
Let's look
on the
into
head,
that.
Like a little bobblehead.
Let's look into that.
I'm going to get into that.
A little bobblehead.
Tiny bobblehead of
slap
Joe.
Him on the side.
Yeah. So again, guys, this is a really hot ass day here in Pittsburgh. So I'm so glad that everyone's.
It's mainit.
Yes, that is Filipino for super hot, or hot in general.
Hot.
Oh my goodness, Joe, you got some good Filipino lingo there going. I like
this
it.
Is a word.
At least you just don't know the bad words like most people do.
I know all the bad words.
I'm pretty
all
sure.
All of them.
Say one. Go ahead. This is uncensored. There you go. So for all of our Filipino viewers out there, he just cussed you out.
Yeah. Right. Not directly, but.
Yeah. Exactly.
You just lost 100 listeners.
Oh, no, Philip. We must turn the radio off.
Oh.
Yeah.
I think he's cussing at that. Very bad.
That's
Very
too bad. Much, guys. So, yeah. Appreciate you all hanging out with us tonight. So kick back and relax. We have a great show in store for you. And yeah, before we get into anything, I'd like to have my co-hosting staff introduce themselves and our special guests.
Joe Corso. I can't even get my right name. My
it's
right
the
name.
Brother.
My name right. Get my merds mixed up. It's Joe Corso, Joe Time Entertainment. Hello.
Cindy here.
Winter?
Yes.
Yeah.
And Doug Mascardo with the band The Floor Shakers.
Yeah.
The Floor Shakers.
Yay. What up, band? What up, fam?
I think your band is in the chat room because there's a lot of people that aren't logged in, and that usually means people are just tuning in
right.
without having to go through the registration. They just want to watch. So.
That's good. We like creepers.
They probably
yes.
want me to pay them for, you know, hey, I checked you out, Doug. So, yeah, you know, that was a full set, right? That's another $100, right?
I guarantee a lot of them are from your Floor Shaker following.
Oh, all three of them are there?
Damn, how'd you know? 1, 2, 3, yeah, they're in the chat room. So, yeah, welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Sam.
And what we have in store later on in the program is a live performance where he's just going to rock on some random tracks and I'm going to play and see if he'll make it into the next level in terms of his guitar quality on top of beats. We'll see.
We're going to shake the floor.
Yeah.
There you
go. Shake it.
Live up to your name, man.
Exactly. And thank you very much for the caps, brother.
Oh, you're welcome.
It's real nice.
Like that?
And Joe got one, but Joe doesn't wear caps.
Put your fucking hat on.
Now they're like a bro.
Oh.
Extra bro-y.
The only time he wears caps is when it's Halloween, when he's in costume.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever seen you wear a hat.
Exactly.
I don't wear hats.
Damn, dude, you look like you dropped like 10 years.
There you go.
Holy shit. There you go. Hey, at least he put it on momentarily.
He did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for that.
There you go. Floor shakers, caps in the house. Can anyone purchase that, or is it like a promotion thing?
Yeah, they want to buy it. Heck yeah, I need a new guitar.
What's the website?
Our website is www.thefloorshakers.com. I'm stuttering.
We're going to freaking mispronounce stuff and totally our vocabulary is out of whack because of this heat. So
right, there you go.
Please excuse us if we're...
That's www.thefloorshakers.com. Thank you.
What's up with the voice? The sexual voice. Yeah.
I just put my finger to my ear.
As we always do, ladies and gentlemen, we have our staff go ahead and do a quick week recap of what's happening, starting off with Mr. Joe time. And Joe, you, as we were talking about on the pre-show, you had a class reunion in the house.
I did.
Yeah, I need to put the applause for that because class reunions are a big thing.
Yeah. You know?
And this was your 10 years.
A decade. Decade from school. Probably a little more. From school. No, but it was awesome, man. I got to see some familiar faces. It wasn't everybody from 05, but, man, shout out to everybody from 05, man. You guys are awesome. But, it wasn't everybody there, but, you know, I still stay in touch with a lot of my close friends since high school.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of them I've known since, like, elementary school. We still hang out. Literally seen them yesterday and the day before that.
Yeah.
Catch games, whatever, you know?
Yeah.
And then, but to see other people that I haven't seen in like 10 years and to hear about their lives and, you know, the progression they have in their careers. We have like lawyers, doctors. It's pretty awesome. I'm a comic. But they're pretty stoked about it. They're like, man, it's pretty awesome. You do stand up comedy and this, that, and the other. And I was like, yeah, man. And so it's cool, you know, because I thought, you know, if I was going to be in my high school reunion, I'd be like, because I thought I was going to go to college. I thought I was going to graduate college. I was going to have, like, my degree in psychology. And
it's not that great, by the way. I'm just saying.
My life went, choop. But, it's been awesome. So it was really cool to share that experience with everybody. And
now, my question to you is, were there any late bloomer hot chicks that stand out? And you know what I'm talking about. The ones that were in high school, were under the radar, and now you see them 10 years later. It's like, boy.
No, I already knew that it was going to be hot when I got older.
Okay, so no surprises.
How did you know that?
Oh, what's that?
How did you know that?
I got this gut feeling when it comes to beautiful women.
Okay.
Yeah.
And were you dead on with pretty much all your predictions?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there any names you want to shout out?
No.
All right, well, let's get into the storyline. Were there anyone in particular that you're like, okay, I knew you were going to be a bomb, and now I want to connect with you?
Yeah.
Well, yes? Okay. See, Cindy, this is how Joe is. Remember when he went to freaking Hawaii and he did that little thing with the airplane sitting next to chick? And he's very secretive about his escapades.
He's discreet.
Very discreet. You know? I'm not going to kiss and tell, but if I fuck her, I'll tell everybody. I'm just kidding.
Oh, the true comedian Joe Time is. I love him.
No. And then also, so I got a bunch of nieces and nephews on the way. This is about that time. My nephew Isaiah Cohen was born on Tuesday. But again, a couple of people passed away
babies.
Too. So it's crazy. So it's everywhere. Like this balance of life. And
Doug, every fucking week, he has a nephew or niece being born. Well, practically. It's around his family.
It's
amazing.
It's the Filipino blood.
Right? Yeah, it is. Yeah.
That's what it is. They may not even be aunts and uncles, but they've been around the family so long.
He's not full Filipino, though. He's half.
He's half?
Yeah.
What's the other half?
Guatemalan.
How did that happen?
San Francisco happened.
That's how it was?
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Everybody. And then, I had a couple shows, but I do have a big announcement. Do I do it now?
Yeah, because you said you would last week. Everybody's been in suspense.
So I locked in the date. I'm shooting September 5th. I'll be shooting my hour special at Tommy T's.
Woo!
All right. Congratulations.
It's going to be a big deal. I'm not going to be pushing it just yet. I'm sitting down with a couple people tomorrow and Wednesday. Just going to kind of get everything rolling and start promotion in the next week or two. And then I wanted to tell everybody that's been tuning to the Slam Show and also keep it to, you know, telling everybody from close friends and family, because once tickets go on sale, I have no way of holding tickets. And
right, right.
Stopping selling out, or if, you know, once that happens, it happens. And then, I don't know, we'll put another show on, but it won't be recorded because this is the only time we have, like, this time frame to record it all.
Gotcha.
So 3 months from now, 3 months from 3 days ago, I think it is.
Now, this is a full production deal where you're going to have it filmed, put on DVD, yep, and that whole thing, kind of like Frankie Quinones.
Yeah, all the audio is going to go on. Yep, we're going to make a comedy album with that.
And that's cool.
Yep, push it on everything. We're going to send it to everybody. We're going to push it to Netflix, Redbox, everything.
All right. That's great. Man. Congratulations on that.
Yeah. If this domino falls the way I'm supposed to, I got a lot of things lined up for it, so it's going to be awesome. So it's going to be...
So September 5th, live recording.
Remember the 5th of September.
Okay.
Okay, see, we
so we're going to be in a front seat, guys.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's Tommy T's Pleasanton, right?
Correct.
Anybody heckles you, I'll punch them in the face.
Perfect. You hear that? I would pay to see that, actually.
Just get it on film.
There you go. And that's where Cindy will have her cameo on the DVD. There I am. Pause it.
Yeah. I'm excited. Yeah, it's trippy. It's gonna be pretty awesome, busy 3 months for me, but I'm ready for it, and you know, got everything rolling.
That's cool, man. Happy for you.
Thank you.
Fantastic.
Cool. All right, rolling along. Cindy, how you doing with the extraordinary headphones as usual?
Oh man, it's tough announcements to follow. Shit.
Yeah. We're gonna have to switch seats one of these days.
Yeah, he ends it. I know, right? It's like, oh well, let's see. I got back from vacation, so I'm poor, so I went back to work. Right.
Like I told you, right? What Homer told me, our resident spiritualist, he would say, just let your credit card heal.
Yes, let my bank account heal. Went back to work. Did a little bit of house sitting. So I've been here in Pittsburgh for 2 days, and it's hot as shit, right? Nasty. And not even windy. And that's the thing. Like, that's something I always remember. It's always windy here. Mm-hmm. And it's totally not at all right now.
It is desert-like.
But I like the heat at night.
At night, yeah, chill. But the rest of the
have the window open, bugs coming in, all that shit, right?
Right, but the rest of the 12, 13, 14 hours that it's not night.
Yeah.
The daytime?
Yeah. Not so much. My parents went to see my sister graduate, so congratulations. Julie Pants. Julie Pants, yeah, she's got her MBA now.
Is that like her full name on this birth certificate?
That's her name in my phone.
Julie Pants.
Yes.
That's a cool name.
And, that stemmed from when we were kids. For some reason, all her pants were always, like, super too short or just, like, really awkward or whatever when we were kids because she was really tall.
Mm-hmm.
And any pants that were, like, too short or awkward looking became, oh, those look like Julie Pants. You know,
right? Trademark Julie Pants.
They're no longer capris, Julie Pants.
No, they're Julie Pants. But see, capris are intentionally short.
That's true.
Yeah.
If your pants are too short when you don't really want them to be, it's
Julie Pants.
It creates that awkward, awkwardness.
Where'd you graduate from?
Somewhere in Seattle. Yeah. Somewhere
in Seattle. Where it rains.
Accredited school.
I forget the name of the school.
All that matters is he graduated.
Yes.
There you go.
And I'm just holding on to my title of family underachiever.
You're not the black sheep, are you? Semi?
No, I wouldn't say that. I would just say underachiever.
All right.
Definitely the family underachiever.
Okay.
So the other two sisters are married homeowners with master's degrees and their shit together.
Yeah.
That's funny.
So,
but they're not on a radio show.
No, they're not.
And exactly. They don't have headphones like that.
They don't.
And they don't got
where did you get those, by the way? Those
are
awesome.
These are, well, Jeremiah got these, I'm guessing, on Amazon. But they're by
Doug's
Monster
like,
Products.
I'm going to get those.
I don't want to plug them too much because we paid for them, but...
My daughter Kyla would love headphones like that.
They're pretty spectacular.
Diamond girl.
I love them.
Believe me, Cindy, if we got a sponsorship with them, then you could plug their asses off. But until then...
They can plug their own asses.
Exactly.
That's right.
For now, they're just called JL.
That's awesome. So cool. Good recap.
Thank you.
Doug from the Floor Shakers, how are you?
I'm doing just fine, thanks. How are you?
Oh, man. I'm just ecstatic. I can't wait till you get on the guitar and rock it later on in
I
the
heard
program.
Him earlier, man. He was jamming.
And he was just fooling around.
Pooting around.
That's it. That's what our guitar players do.
How was your past week?
Oh, my past week was fantastic.
Yeah. Did a lot of things, did a lot of practicing. I'm taking guitar lessons from Jeff Tamalier, who toured with the Tower of Power and Jefferson Starship for a while. He's teaching down there in Antioch. And
see, that's amazing. You are a veteran in the whole guitar game, but yet you still have the inclination to want to learn more, and that's fantastic.
You have to.
Yeah, just advanced education is just wonderful.
Yeah.
Just constantly learning and trying new tempos, new beats. Mm-hmm. And he plays funk guitar amazing. So funk guitar is percussive. So he's teaching me African rhythms right now and trying to translate it onto my guitar. So it's quite a feat. It's very, very technical, and I just love it. It stretches me mentally when I play guitar.
Wow. So. Is he also teaching you how to play with your teeth?
No, by ear.
Like Jimi Hendrix? Yes.
Yeah. Oh, that's a different teacher, but he's dead.
I don't know if that's a pun or something. Right. I could just say, oh, sorry to hear about that.
Right.
No, Jimmy's been dead for years. big time. But big time. No one's ever been playing with their teeth ever since then, right?
They're out there.
Like who? Like
who? You just go on YouTube, and there's going to be some hot shot out there.
Some YouTuber.
Steve Vai. Steve Vai used to do it. Right. Yeah, with the G3 tour. Mm. Yeah.
You should pick that up. Do it for the slam show. Play with your teeth.
I'll try.
All right.
I'll try.
Sorry to cut you off. So continue with your recap.
Then I did that. And let's see. I'm also getting into a little bit of real estate.
Okay.
And that's going really well. And then the band's starting to pick up.
Awesome.
Our season's just started off a couple weeks ago. Summer. We played together.
Summer season.
In Pleasanton. And then we got a wedding coming up at the Brazilian Room in June 26th. We also have another public show, which is the Arinda Summer Concert Series, which is July 7th. And then we're doing the Gilroy Garlic Festival on the main stage.
The Garlic Festival.
Yeah, I love that place. That is a great, great, great festival. And that's July 5th. And I think we go on at about 2 o'clock. Everything will be up on our website.
Hey, Joe, do you know where it's being held at?
What?
The Garlic Festival?
I do not.
It's in Gilroy.
It's in Stanislaus.
Yeah. It's awesome.
Stanislaus, is that Turlock?
No, it's in Gilroy.
Direction.
Yeah. Gilroy Garlic Festival. They even have garlic ice cream.
What?
Everything is garlic.
What about garlic gum?
Probably.
Probably. I would imagine so. It's amazing. You'll go to the festival, and there's this one lone booth in the middle of all of these vendors, and it's garlic ice cream, and the line is like 2 blocks long. And you get this little dinky cup about this big.
What is it, like $20 or something?
No, it's free, but everybody stands in line for it. But they only give you this little cup about this big.
That's hilarious.
It's funny. We're like, oh, wow, garlic ice cream. That looks great. You know,
but nobody knows.
And then some of our fans went out there, and they're like, this is all I got. It's like, oh, wow, here, let me have some of that.
I stood in line for 2 hours for just this?
Yeah. And all I got was this hat.
Hey, that's a dope-ass hat.
Thank you.
There you go.
That's a new color. They were all black, and then I decided to do white ones. So.
Okay.
Then the visors will come out, and then we got some new shirts, ladies' tank tops.
Some swag.
Yeah, some swag.
You have that in the car right now?
No, they're
on order.
Yeah, they're coming in. I was trying to get them all for the show, but...
Hey, at least you got the hats.
I'm going to do so much. And new polo shirts.
There you go.
Yep.
The polo shirts.
Yeah, so we're slamming.
Awesome.
There you go.
Awesome. Cool. That's it? Pretty much on your recap?
Yeah, pretty much for the week.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's great. How was your week?
Oh, I'm going to get into it right now because I always close it out. Yeah, on Thursday, I do my usual residency over at Farrington's Bar over in Pleasant Hill, and that was also game one of the NBA Finals with the Golden State Warriors.
OTW.
Yes, winning in overtime against the Cavs. And, man, if you want a place to watch the game, you have to go to Farrington's this Thursday for game three because that place is ruckus. And, obviously, after the
game. Game three is tomorrow.
I'm sorry?
Game three is tomorrow.
I'm sorry. Game four.
Yeah.
Thank you for that clarity. Heat stroke. Heat thing going on right now. I'm disillusioned. But, yeah, game four over at Farrington's. That's going to be awesome. So, come out. And also, chill with me. because I'll be on the decks, on the ones and twos, closing out the night that evening. On Friday, I'll be at Milo's over in Concord, and that is a happening place. It's the coolest dive bar in the area. No cover charge, no dress code. Just come as you are, kick back, and relax, and hear some tunes. And maybe if you are nice to me, I'll play your request.
Yeah, right.
Not. Just kidding.
By nice, he means start with $20.
Yeah, I have my tip jar, and I have like a list of pricing for particular songs. And the most expensive one is any song by Justin Bieber. Yeah, it says $100, Justin Bieber. That's beneath hard. That, it goes all like the worst type of requests. But hey, that's what's gonna pay the bills.
That's right.
So people pay for those?
Not yet, but...
But they will.
Yeah, but that's the scale that I have.
They got to really love Biebs.
I'll show you the tip jar later. So yeah, that's what's happening on my resident and for the DJ stuff. This past Saturday and Sunday, I had some private events and DJ gig things that put to you this way. I still do a lot of the private parties, as we met the first time. Yep. Over in Pleasanton, that's how Doug and I came in connection. The private parties are a good way of networking, and without that private party, you would never have been here.
Right, exactly, yeah.
And he was so cool. Doug was like, hey, Sam, let's take a selfie. I'm like, all right, cool. Bam. Get up on stage. Let's do it again. I'm like, all right, cool. I was like, I got to get this guy on the program. This guy, Doug from Floor Shakers, is cool as fuck.
That's funny.
Exactly.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So yeah, that was this past weekend, and let's go ahead and roll into last week's guest, which is film director, producer, Lawrence Arte, and this is a little sample of his film, Black Tiger, Hunter Hunted, which we are still trying to find his cameo that he claims he's in, sure. And we have not yet had confirmation if...
He was in the car.
Yeah, he was driving the Beamer.
He was driving the car.
The blacked out windows. That's him.
So, yeah, I wanted to first off give props out to Matt Abaya, because through being the moderator for the Kraken Con Vampira panel, I would never have met Lawrence. And last week, I totally bundled and failed to acknowledge that whole encounter. So, Matthew, thank you.
It was the heat.
Yeah, it wasn't hot last week. But, Matthew, thank you for making the introduction happen. And I just want to give you props out for having Lawrence be part of the network now. So, yeah.
You're the real MVP, yeah. Matt.
So, yeah, let's go ahead and go around the studio and have a little input on last week's guest, Lawrence R. Arte of KidHeroes.net. Hey. Joe.
Beyond words, man.
Beyond words. And you got to figure out something.
No, he was awesome. He was awesome. Everything he was about, everything that is a whole journey, and just how he went from comic book hero to film director extraordinaire.
Yes.
And just his whole way. And now he's teaching classes, and he's just a great advocate of following your passion and, just expressing yourself in any artistic way. And if it could pay the bills, hey, keep pursuing and keep driving and keep developing yourself. And he encourages everybody. He was inspiring to just myself, Sid, Arlene, and
the champ.
And, you know, it was an incredible experience to have him in the studio and just to have him in mind for any upcoming, movies that will be out with him. I'm looking forward to it.
I can't wait to
sit down. Yeah, because we got the Black Tiger, which we watched.
Yeah.
Which I watched.
I watched it too, but Cindy hasn't. Cindy,
I didn't watch it.
It was a really good film.
Yeah.
20 minutes. And
21
and
minutes.
21 minutes, and actually making another one, so that's awesome. And then I haven't got to see Lumpia yet.
Okay.
But they're making a Lumpia 2.
Yeah, I got to hook you up with that.
Yes, please.
That copy, my backup copy.
Yeah. But overall, Lawrence is an incredible individual, and looking forward to connecting with him again soon.
Perfect. Good recap. Cindy.
Something I like about whenever we get somebody on here that's, been super quiet, super shy, is that they have so much built up, and it's all good stuff to say. Is that he had so many stories, he had so many connections, he had so many just references and all these moments where, he might have been quiet and or said the right things at the right time, which, you know, snowballed into him meeting all the right people.
Mm-hmm.
His collection of individual art prints, not just prints, they're all originals, all his little sketch posters that he had are just remarkable.
I couldn't believe he brought all that.
Yeah, all the artists throughout time that he just has a little piece of each and every one of them. There's just so much to learn from a guy like that. And I can't wait to see what he does next.
Yeah, I agree. And he just came in prepared to present what he was all about. And much props to Lawrence for all that he's done so far in his career. Yeah. And we will follow him as he progresses now that he's part of the TVEPN network and the Slam Show. We are going to be kept busy by his workings.
Yeah,
that's for sure.
I love his enthusiasm.
Yeah,
and everything. He's like a kid, like, you know.
Can't beat that.
Yeah,
you can't lost that sense of wonder.
Awesome.
Did he sketch those pictures?
Well, he liked the photos and stuff like that that you're seeing around.
Yeah.
Some of that is his work, but he is also an avid memorabilia collector of great artists, illustrators, and he just has this nice collection. And he brought it. That was the cool thing.
Yeah. Oh, fantastic.
It was stuff like if it got stolen, someone will make $100,000 out of it, that sort of thing. But he brought it here.
Impressive.
Yeah, very impressive. And I tried to scare him. I said, hey, someone, it's gone.
Well, it's not these insured or something.
Exactly. That's a good idea, Cindy. Gotta
I'm
mention
full
that
of
to
them.
Him. All of them. So, yeah, that was our guest, Lawrence, from kidheroes.net. And if you missed that episode, just go to theslamshow.com or theslamshow.tv for the replay. All right. We're going to go ahead and take a quick commercial break, and we have a few topics to talk about before we go into the exclusive interview with Doug of the Floor Shakers. Some funny stuff. You'll like this. Hang tight here on The Slam Show.
You're suffering from chronic pain, migraine headaches, or any other health issues. It might be your back telling you it's time for an adjustment. Come check out the new Health Chiropractic Center in Concord. We restore the curvatures of the spine to bring you back to good health and wellness. Our specialists will provide a full examination and x-rays for free. Just mention The Slam Show. Call now for an appointment at 925-759-9722 or online at thenewhealthcc.com. In order to transform your health, you have to try something new. The New Health Chiropractic Center.
Weekends you want to spend with family, friends, doing stuff that you love. You don't want to spend weekends looking for a new car, burning through weekend after weekend on the hunt. Instead, you got to check TrueCar and the TrueCar mobile app. In 5 minutes, TrueCar's app not only lets you build the car that you want, it tells you what others paid for it and lets you lock in guaranteed savings, usually over $3,000 less than MSRP. So get your weekends back at the car you want without stressing over overpaying. Save time, save money, and never overpay. Download the TrueCar app today.
What are you doing?
I'm turning this hedge into a dolphin-shaped topiary.
But this house isn't yours. In fact, I just showed it to you.
Oh, I'm gonna buy it.
Softly confident.
Well, I am an excellent candidate for a home loan. I pulled an 809 FICO score at Experian.com, so getting a mortgage is merely a formality.
What do you think I should do with this other hedge? A giraffe?
Get your credit swagger on. Become a member of Experian Credit Tracker and find out your FICO score powered by Experian. FICO scores are used in 90% of credit decisions.
I'm a mid-century architectural wonder. A house made entirely of glass. So you can imagine my fright when giant pieces of hail started falling from the sky. Did I mention I'm made entirely of glass? Everyone was running here, running there, trying to get out of the house. But what am I to do? I am the house.
Your house can't protect itself. That's why the Geico Insurance Agency helps make it easy to switch and save on homeowners insurance. You could save even more when you combine your homeowners with an existing auto insurance policy. Call Geico, go to geico.com, or visit your local office.
Are you living with pain? So was Lisa, a brave Marine wounded in Iraq.
After surviving an explosion, I was on horrible painkillers. I tried 1 hour pain relief, and now I'm pain-free all day without dangerous side effects. And it works in less than 1 hour.
Try it free for 1 week and pay only the shipping with no automatic shipments. Call 800-500-1810 right now or visit onehourpainrelief.com. That's 800-500-1810. 800-500-1810.
Who did you let down today? If you're drinking too much or doing too many drugs, you probably let a whole bunch of people down. And I bet you're not sleeping very well either. Well, we can help you at the Detox Hotline. Let us be your recovery concierge. And don't think this is just another treatment ad. I promise you, we are different. We'll put you in a luxury-like getaway where our painless detox process will fix your addiction problem. And in no time at all, you'll get your life and your sleep back. Painless Detox is here, and our recovery concierge service will work with your insurance company to maximize your coverage. We are different. Let us help you break your addiction to drugs and alcohol before it's too late. Take 5 minutes of your time and call right now. I promise it will change your life. 800-885-2600. 800-885-2600.
Geico Motorcycle presents Reflections from the Road.
Let me tell you, the road is a much more relaxing place since I switched to Geico Motorcycle Insurance and started saving money. With that taken care of, now I can think about deep, important things. Like how come it's a pair of pants when there's only one of them? A real brain teaser. But hey, at least saving money with Geico Motorcycle is as easy as pie. What does that mean anyway?
Geico Motorcycle Insurance. See how much you could save.
Do you need working capital for your business? Don't wait months for the bank approval. Get the cash you need today at businessloanstoday.com. Even if you've been turned down from a local bank, at businessloanstoday.com, we provide alternative financing to retailers, restaurants, hotels, contractors, auto mechanics, and hundreds of other businesses. Unlike banks, our unique financing services are flexible, with repayment plans tailored to meet your needs. There's no collateral required, and loans are not based on your personal credit score. The only requirement is that you've been in business at least 1 year and have sales of over $20,000 per month. Getting the cash your business needs is easy. Just fill out our simple application and we'll customize your financing to fit your needs. Then, within 24 hours after approval, your funds are available up to $250,000. Thousands of business owners are turning to alternative financing instead of standard banks. The application only takes a few minutes, so call Business Loans today at 800-669-9801 and see what you qualify for. That's 800-669-9801. 800-669-9801.
Welcome back to the Slam Show. This is the topic segment sponsored by Mello's Pizza in Dino's. Pleasant Hill. Sorry. Again, blame it on the damn heat. Davino's in Pleasant Hill. Yes. So
thank you too, manager Anna and crew.
Exactly.
I'm going to take the whole box.
I need to bring in the whole box after that little blunder. Davino's, our sponsor this week on the Slam Show. Thank you very much. All right, guys. Let's go ahead and roll into our first topic. So check this out. What does this look like to you?
X-ray.
A femur.
Pretty much. Muay Thai fighter Bandasak Charyasan has been suspended by the World Muay Thai Council following his May 16th victory via head kick knockout. And this was in a bout in Thailand. And guess what? They found out through X-ray images titanium shin implants were discovered. And boy,
it's illegal.
Big time.
Well, I don't know if in Thailand, but here in America.
Can you believe that? Now, he claims that the implants were used to help him recover from an injury, but a lot of people are just doubting this idea. And here's the thing. If you're going to go ahead and have an operation process like this done, it's going to cross your mind that you're going to go ahead and say, well, if I could go ahead and have a titanium rod, who's to say that that could be used as an advantage for my bouts? Fortunately, something, either he hit the guy and he was like, wait a second, he's hitting me like fucking Wolverine. So something's up. And they did the x-rays and he's busted. That just leads me to like, man, if people could go ahead and get away with titanium implants to some degree, what else can you have your body part where you could just go ahead and just customize it? We have everyone doing boob implants, tattoos,
those don't
everything.
Really help you fight, though.
Just having something you know is indestructible.
Well, that's how big they are.
I mean, we're talking about something indestructible that you could use.
Right.
That makes you think, like, hey, why not? Just to have it. Let me just have my freaking forearm here, freaking titanium.
What do you
so,
mean, jacks?
Something like that.
Mm. Yeah, it's a perfect example of a concealed weapon, right?
Thank you. Exactly. So let's go ahead and do the round table and get everyone's opinion on this. Joe, Is it something you want to dive into later on in life? Have a freaking body part that you could go ahead and whack someone like, okay, I'm done. There's no need to have this fight continue. Bam!
I already have that.
As is.
Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I bet.
I don't want to pay for no implants like that. That's ridiculous. I mean, if I had it in my body, aren't they supposed to, isn't there like a disclosure law that they disclose that you have rods in your legs?
I guess not in Thailand, right? Thailand.
So why would they suspend him then?
That's, the council said it.
That's crazy.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
But if I had him, I'd use it for sure.
Yeah, like say for example, because you do play a lot of outdoor activities mm-hmm. and so forth, flag football, and all of a sudden your freaking shin goes out, and like, man, well, let me go ahead and put a titanium rod there while I'm doing my healing process, leave it in, and there you go. Your freaking quarter way of
Bionic
Wolverine.
Man.
Exactly. Would that be an option?
If my Obamacare takes care of all that, then yeah.
Yeah, there you go. As long as the health insurance covers it. Yeah.
As long as Obama covers it, I'm cool.
I'm all good.
Might as well put titanium rods in both of the shins.
Yeah.
Can you put it on the other one? What's wrong with it? No, nothing. Just put it in there.
I just want them to match.
Yeah. Oh, no. Thank you.
That's funny. Nah, yeah. I have no say in it. I don't know. Like, if I was the guy getting whacked by it, yeah, I complain. If I was the guy whacking the guy, I wouldn't, you know, whatever.
Put you this way. When the zombie apocalypse comes and you're already freaking titanium up, you're going to be like, yeah, motherfucker, I'm ready.
Still gets your bloodstream, you're going to be a zombie anyway.
That's true.
Or you pull it out yourself and use it as a weapon.
Yeah,
there you go. Concealed. It's changing the term concealed weapon, ladies and gentlemen. Cindy.
Well, I mean, if you look at people who've had injuries, if you look at like Anderson Silva when he broke his leg on TV, did you guys see that fight?
Yeah.
Oh man, that was freaking gross.
Yeah. If you had an injury like that, I could see putting the titanium rod in. But
they would have to take it out before the fight.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, he probably let that shit heal with splints, and that's why he was out for so long.
Okay.
You know, if you're a professional fighter, you probably wouldn't want to get something like that until you retire from fighting and you need to fix your shit anyways.
Yeah,
you know, all your repetitive stress injuries need to be treated.
I think it looks cool. Like, look at motherfucker. I got fucking...
Looks very cool, but if you're still competing,
yeah,
you probably don't want to tread on that.
Okay, okay.
Who is this guy? He's just some...
He's a Muay Thai fighter out of Thailand.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's all mainly kickboxing, right?
Yeah, a lot of kicking.
That style of kicking?
Yeah.
Because most of them get their bones are already, like, solid. Because, like, the average human bones, they have pockets of holes.
Okay.
Where the calcium breakup is.
Okay, break it down.
And then when it takes so much traumatic force,
okay,
what it does is when it heals, it comes back even more thicker. So it won't be breaking that same area. Yeah, and then if it keeps doing that, then it's like Wolf's Law, it's called, or something like that. So by that time, your whole bone is just one solid thing. It won't break anymore. So that's the same. It's equivalent.
Or it takes a lot.
Yeah. That's why a lot of those fighters, I mean,
yeah,
these fighters, but the ones that don't compete like that, they have hard body training. That's what they do.
Yeah. There you go. Spit
so you
the gotta
signs. Be like Jean-Claude Van Damme kicking down a tree.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Jackie Chan.
It's really trippy.
In the kickboxer movie.
There you go. There you go. Doug, what do you think of this?
What do I think that? Well,
would you have a freaking titanium music part in your body?
Yeah, probably my fingers, and I wouldn't have to use a slide when I did some blues and stuff like that.
Nice.
Except they'd be on the exterior of my finger, though.
Right. Right.
But I think it's just dangerous to have that as a, you know, if you're in full contact fighting, to have that implant in there, whether it's your arm or your leg.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, to put it in there for healing purposes.
Yeah.
Yeah, but at least remove it.
You didn't.
You know?
That's how he got busted.
Yeah.
He was like, fuck it.
Well, does he have any medical record of his injury that he could use as... evidence for his argument.
Yeah, and how long has he had it on there? And if he has any belts, is that revoked?
Look, we're getting too deep on this because this is Thailand.
Right.
Thailand, anything goes. Remember,
really?
We're talking about Bangkok. All right?
Well, if anything goes, then why are they mad at him?
Yeah.
Right. I mean, the alarm should have went off when he went through the airport, right? Excuse me, what is this? It's just my leg, dude.
Exactly. Exactly. So, yeah, that's going to be food for thought if anyone's titanium. Really, yeah.
It's not antimanium, though. Right?
No, not. I'm telling you. That's close enough. Vibranium. That's from Avengers Age of Ultron. Have you seen that yet?
Yeah.
Age of Ultron? Have you?
What is
everybody's caught up.
Avengers 2, Age of Ultron.
Oh, I have not seen that.
That's what Captain America has on his shield, right?
That's right. That's what it's made of. I like your IQ there, Joe. Right on.
Captain America movie.
Captain America.
There you go. Marvel plug there on the Slam Show, ladies and gentlemen. All right, moving on to our next topic. Check this out. Electronic billboard job advertising for strippers has been erected in the Las Vegas area. Little Darlings in Las Vegas is currently running it with text displays saying pay your way through college or now auditioning high school grads. These electronic billboards are placed over by Interstate 15 and everyone and their mama could see it. So let's go ahead and get our opinions on this. Me personally, it's kind of touchy. It is, because you have to keep in mind you're talking about already pointing the direction of a particular job description that may tend to be kind of sensitive to some people, but it is what it is. It is starting to be the norm where everyone will embrace the whole culture and how that could be supplementing one's income in the right way, used in the right way. So I don't see any problem with it. I feel that it's going to be something where it just, hey, it's a job. If you want to take it, you take it. If you don't, then turn away, find something else. Maybe parents might be sensitive. They're driving around. They have their college grad with their tassel going down. They're like, oh, mommy, can I, do you mind?
Who takes their new grad to Vegas? Who goes to Vegas with their parents?
That's funny.
Hey, some of these generation parents now, they're partying. Look at Justin Bieber's dad. He's like freaking VIP bottles
VIP
and everything.
Yeah.
He's That's out funny. Of control.
Living through his son.
Exactly.
Right, must be nice.
He'll probably come to you one
tier.
Time and pay you $100 to play his song.
Yeah. And I will play it. I'll say, you're Justin Bieber's dad? No problem.
I got the whole anthology right here.
I don't even have to download it. It's already in my library. I have a folder and everything is on there. So I like to have our studio personalities give their opinion on this Lil Darlings business model going on. Joe.
So is it just the fact that there's a text saying, hey, if you're a college graduate, I mean, if you're a high school graduate,
high
you're
school
looking
graduate,
for a job,
yeah.
We're hiring. It's very economically sound.
I agree.
And they pay taxes, I'm sure.
Yes,
especially
yes.
Especially in Nevada.
Yes.
And, you know. I don't really see anything wrong with it. Maybe if it was in, you know, San Francisco, you know, where I'm not sure, like.
There's the Little Darlings there.
There's a.
Yeah.
So now, what I'm kind of guessing is that there's a demographic difference here. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
All right.
If you out there, I mean, you got a billboard with the dudes from the guy strippers, too. You
know? Yeah, but they're not asking the guys to apply for a job.
Fresh out of high school.
Yeah,
yeah,
right.
Fresh out of high school.
Dudes fresh out of high school.
Plus the guy went, it's a really strict audition, and they have,
yeah.
It's like
so this is like an open casting, come on through.
Yeah,
you got a job,
different.
Regardless.
Yeah.
And I think the reason why they can get away with that is that they're a juice club. They don't serve any alcohol in there. That's why they can solicit.
Joe, how the fuck do you know? How do you know?
Are we talking about the same?
Well, yeah. I mean, yeah, if you look at that billboard, and this is a stipulation legally, is
Doug,
since they are.
Man, I need to hang out with you. You're like on top of this shit.
You got to learn this stuff because if
you're
a band
new.
Leader, you know, you're at the.
He's a floor
the
shaker.
Bullseye of the entire target.
That's why they call them the floor shakers.
Yeah,
right.
There you go. So.
Floor shakers.
Legally, they can do it because it's a juice bar. They don't serve any alcohol,
okay.
So they can actually.
Little Darlings.
Yeah.
You're sure of that?
Positive. Absolutely.
If it's a nude club, they don't have alcohol.
Yeah,
if it's only a topless club,
right.
They do.
So even in Sacramento, there's a couple clubs up there that are juice bars too.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, that can actually play out in California, I do believe.
Okay.
Yeah, same rules.
I don't think it's a good thing. Just, just because of the lifestyle, and there's a lot of bad avenues you can go in once you enter a club like that and start making money doing that. But you know,
gateway job.
Yeah, I mean, too many temptations for young minds to go through something like that.
Okay,
right. That's good though. It challenges the parents now.
Yeah, I mean, with everything, instant information on everything.
I'm just glad they specified high school graduates instead of like still in high school, yeah, barely legal. Exactly.
Well, if they're 18 and they're still in high school legally,
and you know that
they can apply,
that happens. Well, you know, this is nothing new. So I mean, for people to act like they're shocked about it, it's like, come on, wake up. You know, this is nothing new. This has always been around. 18 is age of consent in California and Nevada. You know, that's something that is a big part of the economy in Las Vegas.
Right.
Yep.
And, you know, like, that audience goes for younger and younger and younger, and that's just a gross reality. That's part of the appeal. That's part of the taboo. That's part of people feeling like they're kind of doing something a little more wrong, just because strip clubs have become so, like, normal and not as taboo anymore. They have to kind of push the envelope a little bit, right, to make them feel a little more sinful for that appeal, I think, at least, because they're super saturated and mainstream now. And the longer you get exposed to these kind of industries, the more you realize that there's a lot of pedo pervy people that are the ones that are really driving that kind of business. It's not the guy that's only there twice a year for a bachelor party or birthday.
Right.
You know, those guys, those are, you know, normal guys, normal everyday guys, might go to the strip club every once in a while. But the people that are really driving the business and spending a lot of money in there are the guys with some social dysfunction, yeah, and some, exactly, something lacking somewhere else in their life that they're in there all the time. So, I mean, saying high school girl, school girl, that's a really popular played out fantasy. You know, they're just advertising. Businesses answer demands. That's one thing that I will always tell people. If you get mad for a certain business opening or closing, businesses just answer demands. And if that upsets you, you should be more upset with the shitheads and dirtbags around you than the business. Because that's a wake-up call to what's really around you.
So
I like how you pointed at Joe and Doug on that one.
No, not you guys specifically.
Oh, yeah. We don't want to talk about Mr. Time's exploits in earlier years. Did I slip up on that? Sorry.
That's fun.
Yeah, you made extremely great points there, Cindy. And, yeah, when it comes down to it, and I'll echo what Joe said, it's about how the parents are going to start having to play a bigger role now, where they're trying to stand with their children to make sure that, okay, that is an option.
Let
but
they'll probably work with them at the strip club, too.
Yeah, there you go. That's reality. So because we are in a generation where every information is so instantaneous, that's where the parents have to stand up and say, hey,
especially nowadays.
Exactly. Every day there's new content that's distracting the kids from going through the traditional ways of getting an education and having a career.
Right.
Parents need to go ahead and just say, hey, that's there, but this is what I know is proven and will work. So believe me on this.
Yeah. Just surface level education. It's crazy.
Put down the Instagram for a minute.
It's like reading a book and reading a book on a tablet, right? You know, you can open the pages and open the book,
correct,
and learn and read. But now you have tablets that you flick the page and you hear the page turn.
Yeah.
And it just moves over.
And it reads to you.
It was funny. My daughter, Kyla, she was reading me this book online. And she asked me, Dad, can we get the book? And I said, sure. How much is it? She said, okay. And I said, so are you going to get it online? She goes, no, Dad, it's a book. I'm like, sure, let's get it. Because she's going to read a book, and she's not going to read it off her phone or off her tablet.
Gotcha, it's a physical hard copy.
That's the beauty of having a book and holding it in your hand and turning the pages, and it's just
different vibration.
It gives you, what am I trying to say?
It's more engaging.
Yeah, it's more engaging.
Yeah, and it's a grounded thing, and it's back to normal.
Yes.
It's just like vinyl records and cassettes and 8-tracks, as we were talking
about.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, he is from the 8-track generation. And proud of it.
Got yeah. A free bird cut off in the middle of the song, man.
I hate it. Stairway to Heaven. Those are the two longest songs.
And you have to press that button.
Yeah, it's like track 4? Okay, here we go.
That's too much. All right, guys. We're going to go ahead and take a quick music break and be back with our special guest, Doug from the Floor Shakers. And do you want to go into like a song once we get out of the music break? Or do you want to go into the actual interview?
No, whatever you want to do. Doesn't matter to me.
All right. Yeah. There you go. That's what I like about our guests. There's like, whatever.
Whatever.
No problem.
Yeah. Whole commercial to decide.
Yeah. There you go.
We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
I was gonna kill a couple rappers, but they did it to themselves. Everybody's suicidal, they didn't even need my help. This elementary, I'd probably go to jail if I shoot at your identity and bounce to the left. Stuck a flag in my city, everybody's screaming Compton. I should probably run for mayor when I'm done, to be honest. And I put that on my mama and my baby boo too. 20 million walking out the court, baby, woo woo. Oh yeah, f*** the judge, I made it past 25. And there I was, a little nappy-headed nigga with the world behind him. Life fake, but a fat screaming, Annie, are you okay? Annie, are you okay? Limitinant with a gold play straight from the bottom. Mr. Belly at a beast, from a peasant to a prince to a king. Oh yeah, where you and I was born.
By the time you hear the next pop, the funk shall be within you.
Now I'm gonna get the whole world talking. Everybody wanna cut the legs.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go ahead and go into our special performance with our guest from the Floor Shakers, Doug Mascardo. He's going to do a little guitar magic here on the Slam Show Live. Take it away.
Thank you.
Keep it going. I was gonna turn down, but I'm grooving. Amazing. Amazing.
There we go. I'm like, where's that real applause?
the real applause.
Yeah. That is a beautiful, beautiful guitar, man.
Now, you had a little story with the guitar, right? Oh. Or was it another one?
It was another one.
Okay, okay. One. This one has a clean story. You didn't get it from a dead person or anything.
I usually I don't buy brand new guitars. I like to buy guitars that have a little story behind them.
Really? You're not this is not a joke.
Not a joke.
Really?
Every guitar that I've owned, actually, there was one brand new guitar that I did buy, and I was going through
a breakup,
a troubled time in my life. I had to get away from the people that I was hanging out with back in the day, and it was kind of like a crossroad. So I went down to Guitar Center,
mm-hmm.
and
the one here in Concord or Frisco?
The one in Concord.
Okay.
And I really wanted to get into playing acoustic guitar, and so I bought this beautiful Fender Cutaway acoustic guitar, and I sat there at Point Malade at the foot of the Richmond Bridge, staring into Marin County. And I wrote a song, and then I knew that I had to move to Marin County.
Mm-hmm.
And so I jumped in my Jeep, asked my sister, hey, can I live in your condo? And she was happy enough to open it up for me. And I lived in Marin County for about 8 years and got my act cleaned up. And it was just a beautiful, beautiful time in my life after I made that decision buying that guitar. So,
nice.
Applause for the guitar.
So you still got a story behind buying the guitar?
Oh, yeah. And so, but that was the only brand new one I got. All the other ones had a story. I have a 1957 Gibson Les Paul custom shop guitar.
Mm-hmm.
I went back to my hometown, Fremont, where I needed to get away from.
Freakmont.
And I had one of my closest friends back there. His name was Danny Nevis. And I went to visit him one day. and he had his friend we went to school with, and I said hi and how are you, and she goes, do you still play guitar? Mom, yeah, I still play guitar. She goes, do you want to buy one? And I said, well, let me take a look at it. So she opens up this old beat up case, and inside it had purple fur on the inside of this Gibson case. Mm. And there was this.
And it said Prince.
It said Prince on it. And there was this red 57 Gibson custom shop guitar inside of it. Beautiful guitar, receipts, everything. And I said, decent, really? You're going to sell me this guitar? She goes, yeah.
Just like that, yeah.
Yeah, I just broke up with my boyfriend and he's such a jerk. He goes, you give me $800 for that guitar right now, and it's yours. I said, I'll be back. So I went, I purchased a guitar, and it just, guitars are part of you when you become a musician, just like any instrument. So I'll know within a couple minutes of playing any instrument because the neck will warm up, the body will mold to me, mm-hmm. and I'll be able to just do a simple blues riff like I did with this one right here. And then I'll know that guitar is for me, mm-hmm. and then I'll buy it. So to get back to the Les Paul story, so there I was performing a couple months later, and a friend of mine comes walking into the show, and I point at him, hey, how you doing? He goes, oh, great. He goes, man, that guitar looks familiar. I'm like, yeah, I just bought it. He goes, you didn't buy that from Deesa. She's my ex-girlfriend. And I said, well, yes, I did. Nope. So he went one way, and I went out the back with the guitar and the band and the paycheck. But I have that guitar still, and it's a beautiful guitar. And Marshall is a wonderful guitar. Thank you very much. I still have it today.
How many guitars do you own total?
I have 14.
Damn.
Wow.
Just like a sneakerhead, you got you're a guitar head.
And three of them are I just use for memorabilia. Mm-hmm. One of the guitars I have is it's a Joe Satriani custom mm-hmm. shop model. Signed by Joe Satriani himself, Ronnie Montrose, Jonathan Kane, Tommy Castro.
Any Eddie Van Halen stuff?
No, Eddie Van Halen can't get close to him or his ego.
I sense there's a story with that. And you know he's part Filipino, right?
No way.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. So you should you know, come talk to him. Use your accent. Yeah. You know,
Eddie, try me to baleo. I hear the boys in the band want to start that up again.
That's funny.
That's too much. So let's go ahead and back up a little bit. How did you get into music back in the early days?
Well, back in the early days, when I pick up the guitar? I think I picked up the guitar when I was 11. My buddy Craig Hayworth.
Was that the very first instrument? You didn't like have drums or
nothing? That was the
tuba or anything?
No, not a tuba. No, it was just a guitar. Straight up. Okay. My next door neighbor had a guitar, and he was, God, now I'm dating myself. He was back in, he was playing a bunch of Crosby, Stills, and Nash, and Neil Young, the band and stuff like that. And I thought that was like, oh, wow, this is just so real and so live. I got to play this guitar.
Mm-hmm.
So I learned how to play. I would pick up my guitar at 6:30 in the morning, and I was terrible. My sister would pound on the door. I had an electric guitar, of course, and she would pound on the closet door. Turn that thing down. You can't play. You can't play. And I'd turn it up louder and louder and louder. So after about 6 years of that, she moved to college. but she's been, my sister Allison has been one of the greatest supporters of my musical projects.
There you go. She came around eventually.
Yeah, she came around. And then back in the day when I was doing original music, I never really did covers.
Mm-hmm.
So I was writing a lot, and the band was called Gypsy Wind.
Gypsy wind.
it was great. I was
Oh, we have a correction on the whole Eddie Van Halen. He's part Indonesian, and the part Filipino one is a Metallica guitarist.
Right.
Yeah.
Kirk Hammett.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So thank you, Matt from Vampiria, for clarifying that. Appreciate it.
And
MVP.
So when I had a band called Gypsy Wind, we were first starting out. And
I picture you with like a feather earring when you say that.
Yeah, some long hair, maybe some fringe.
Yeah, long hair.
I try to get a picture up, ladies and gentlemen, but he has yet to send that to
me. Oh,
was that the Gypsy Wind photo?
Yeah, there was a Gypsy Wind photo in there.
Because you're like, I saw you open up some folders, and you're like, no.
Right.
Like, all right, he's not going to send it.
Yeah. So.
And this is with makeup on, right? You had makeup?
Oh, not back then, because we were. Oh, actually, was it then? I can't remember. Yeah, actually, we were doing makeup because we turned into a glam band, and that's what happened. That's what it was. It's all coming back to me now. So my sister, she would it was pay to play back then at the Omni, Wolfgang's, couple
Can
of other cabaret.
Can you imagine that?
But it was a beautiful time. I mean, everybody was just playing all this terrible music, and we were having so much fun. Yeah. And it was Marshall Stacks, and all the cool guitars came out, that Ibanez and BC Rich and all those beautiful Mockingbird guitars that came out.
That's one in the picture there.
Oh, yeah, there it is right there. Awesome. That's fantastic. So,
I have that on Guitar Hero.
My sister, bless her soul, she would buy up all the tickets because you had to sell, in order to play on the stage back then, you had to sell $300 worth of tickets.
Oh, wow.
Right. This is back in 1988,
it's a bringer show.
I mean, $5 ticket. My sister, hey, I got a show coming. Okay, bye. And it's like, oh my God, how am I gonna pay for this? But she would buy all of her tickets, all the tickets, so we can play.
Oh wow! What?
And bring her friends, and
ate.
And it was yeah, it was so much fun, so much fun.
Wow, you owe her a lot.
I do.
At least
to this day.
Yeah, per show.
And how many shows did she do that for?
Oh,
a dozen?
My God, we how many shows we did? We did.
Fuck.
We did 28 shows 1 year.
Do the math.
Yeah, 28 shows. And we were everywhere. We were having so much fun, and she was so broke. And she let me move into her condo in Marin County. But
what was she doing at the time, job-wise? Just curious.
She was doing benefits, I think. She worked for a benefit company.
Okay.
That's why her heart was so big.
Yeah, exactly. So so it was just a wonderful time.
Mm-hmm.
Carl Alameda, if you're still out there, how are you? Carl Williams. Greg Williams. Who is our keyboard player? Well, I forget what his name was, but he had an anxiety attack and left one day.
Seems like you're always connected to these individuals.
Oh, yeah. Same. Well, it's amazing. Like, some of the most talented people have like the biggest issues when they're performing.
A lot of pressure.
Yeah, it is. It is. But when they're on stage, it all comes out and you can just tell.
And it all comes together.
Yeah. Yeah. For those few moments that you're all on stage.
That's cool. Yeah. That's cool. Now, who was your major influences in music?
Neil Schon. Oh, Neil Schon was
Mr. Journey.
Yeah, he lit it up for me when guitar solos came. In the original Journey albums that came out, Journey Next, Looking to the Future.
What do you think of the Filipino lead singer now, Journey?
I think he's awesome.
Cool.
Yeah, I think he's awesome.
Arnel Pineda.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, fantastic.
I heard he's Filipino.
Very much so. He's like as Filipino as you can get.
That's
funny.
And it's a great story how everything came about. It's a tearjerker.
Just fantastic.
Yeah. You got to check that out, Cindy, if you don't know the background.
They found them on YouTube.
I will do that. Yeah.
I want that guy. He's the one.
Yeah,
just like Sage will always say, you're going to get stuck eventually. You keep doing that accent.
Yeah, for real.
So, continue.
Yeah, so Neil Schon really lit it up for me, just the way he played. And he was a self-taught guitar player.
Wow.
And I think back then when he was first playing, he hooked up with Carlos Santana,
mm-hmm.
and then he formed Journey, the original Journey, before they went commercial. And those albums were just...
And you have 8 tracks of those, right?
Yeah, <actually.
laughs> the original Journey ones before "Don't Stop Believing."
Right, you know, with Greg Raleigh, Ross Valerie, Ansley Dunbar, and Neil Schon.
Mm-hmm.
Just fantastic works of music. And then that's when I started to pick up and learn how to solo and play electric guitar.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
And then that was it. Then, of course, you know, Santana and Satriani. Yeah. Sammy Hagar was one of my favorite singers.
I can't drive 55.
Yeah. Rock Candy. And so I've been a rocker for a long, long time.
Gotcha.
And
but the cool thing is you play all genres of music, and that's a fantastic thing. Not back then. Yeah, your makeup and all glam shit.
Yeah, spandex, the whole thing.
Oh, yeah, spandex.
Tight ass freaking bicycle shorts and shit.
Yeah, there you go. I still got those bicycle shorts. And a new bike.
That's funny.
Nobody knows.
So, during this time, were you at your Let's Make Original Music stage, or did it come later?
Yes, it was all original music back then because... There was just something about writing your own song.
Of course.
To make it your own.
Now, what were the types of music that you were trying to write or try to duplicate? Was it more of the Journey sound? Was it a mixture of certain elements? What was the sound you were going for?
Wow, I guess they were all rock ballads back then.
Really,
everything
slow
was
jams.
Everything was a rock. Ballads. Everything was a rock ballad. You know, nice acoustic guitar, and then also
close my eyes.
Yeah, and it was so much fun. I used to walk around high school in the hallways, Irvington High School.
Shout out!
And I used to. My mom bought me a 12-string acoustic guitar, mm-hmm. and I loved that guitar. So I would walk down the hallways because the reverb in these long hallways with the lockers and stuff like that, the guitar would just resonate. But I didn't know, or I didn't realize at the time, that I was cutting class and the teachers could hear me play down the hallway.
Oops.
And one of the teachers, Ben McEntee, he had creative writing. He was an English teacher. He would always pull me into his class, and I would always play in front of his class for 15 minutes, and then he would tell me, you got to go. I'm like, well why? He goes, you just got to go. So I would leave, and then all of a sudden I would see the AP and the principal coming down.
That's funny.
But, yeah, I always had my guitar in my hand back in high school. And
did you cut class and all that shit?
I did it all. Wow.
You're straight up like a C student?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. And then I was the car club president. I had the nicest hot rods and played guitar, and my hair was long, and, yeah. Total rebel back then.
That's awesome.
That's so cool. Let's go ahead and have...
You got an A+ in my book.
Thank you, Joe.
You know this track, right?
So Armageddon?
Yes.
That's right. Yeah. Now...
Get your power ballad.
Man. That's the power ballad. So we're gonna go ahead and have Joe and Cindy, starting off with Joe. Give a little question there to Douglas.
Yeah, man. Like, out of all your guitars, which one is like your Excalibur?
My Excalibur. Gosh.
You know, your katana.
Well, today it's this one. Yeah. So it
changes up.
It
right?
changes up.
Depends.
Yeah, it really depends on
the story.
That the mood that I'm in when I hit the stage, I'll always bring 3, maybe 4 guitars with me, and so right now I'm kind of going through this Fender stage. So I have a cool Fender Stratocaster that I picked up about a year ago. Oh, maybe it was 2 years ago. Great story behind that.
Please.
I went on Craigslist and I was looking for a Stratocaster, and I answered this ad, call the guy, and the guy's all, man, my wife's pregnant. I have to pay my taxes, and I'm selling this guitar. Can you help me out? I go, how much? So, $900. I said, I'll be back. And
you don't negotiate it. You just take it as it is.
Well,
right?
I mean, it's, you know, I'm helping the guy out.
Yeah.
Right? And, you know, I mean, he's got a baby on the way. Yeah, taxes. Right? He's got his taxes coming in. He's only offering $900 for the guitar.
They get it's like, hey, like you're helping. $1,400.
Yeah,
anyways,
exactly.
So.
And it's like, you know, I'm helping you out. Give me the guitar. The guitar's got a story behind it. I picked up the guitar 2 minutes in my hands. I knew I wanted it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I just asked him how much. And mm-hmm. I said, okay. So, thank you very much. Have the guitar. So, I've been playing these two guitars, that one, for the past, probably 80% of the time I hit the stage.
Wow.
For the past couple of years.
And when did you buy her? Or is it him?
It's an it.
It's a shim.
I have a friend of mine, his name's Tim Evans, and he has this phenomenal guitar collection. He's got every guitar imaginable in his house.
Where does he live?
He is one of the best guitar players I've ever been honored to share the stage with.
Wow.
And collector.
And collector. So this is from his collection.
Mm-hmm.
I'll call him up every now and then and say, hey, Tim, you know, you got a guitar that you got for sale? And he'll always tell me, no. And then a couple days later, it's like, bam! You know, here's pictures. It's going on Craigslist. You can get it right now. And but he always keeps his guitars in, like, brand new condition, pristine. No matter how old they are. They're in cases. All the cases have little tags on them. Right, you go open up his closet, and his closet, instead of clothes, just guitars.
Yeah.
And there's these little tags everywhere. And, oh, this one. And
that's so cute. Kind of like when women put their shoes in categories and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. It kind of reminded me, I have a friend. She puts her shoes in shoe boxes, and then she'll
take a picture
of the shoes and tape it to the shoe box.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're...
Yeah.
Is that...
That's common.
Is that common?
Very common.
Really?
Yeah.
It's not common, but it's a good idea.
Yeah. You're not on that city?
I just have a pile of shoes.
Okay. All right.
There's very few that still have the box.
That's funny.
And so I got that from, I call him Tim's House of Guitars.
Gotcha.
Yeah. And he sold me a... George Benson GB30, which is a red guitar, which actually I just brought that to the stage. I used that
over at the Pleasanton event.
At the Pleasanton event.
Yeah.
Love that guitar. So that's my new battle axe for this season right now. So it just all depends.
When you mentioned about bringing three guitars for each gig, is it because you have the tendency to feel it out and say, okay, that isn't what I want to play tonight, or just have it as a backup in case a string breaks? What's the idea behind it?
There's always strings breaking and backup guitars. But it's just kind of, I'll have my mind set during rehearsals and whatever songs that we're coming up or we're going to play to get that certain sound.
Mm-hmm.
And then once I start loading out, I'm like, oh, I should take this one. And then I'm going to take this one.
Yeah.
And then I'll just load it back up. And then away, the next thing you know, I got 3-4 guitars in the back. And it's kind of like, well, you know, you could have put more gear back there. So now I got all these guitars.
This is my Let's Groove one. This is my Uptown Funk. And this is,
Yeah.
Do you kind of already tune it out so you don't have to tweak it later when you do have several guitars on?
Well, I mean, you got to tune anyways because the room, the ambient temperature and everything like that changes with the neck. And the neck's, you know, it's wood. So it bends and stretches and stuff like that. So
it's unlike a tuba.
Yeah.
Actually, the tuba? Temperature affects brass instruments too.
Yeah, exactly.
And they have a little bit of Filipino in them.
Oh, man. Joe is having a Filipino redemption night. I love it.
The tuba's German.
That was German.
It's Swiss.
That's and then awesome. I have one last one. What's that called? Have you ever... did a love ballad like to like a chick like this is for you, and you're like
standing out in their front yard and shit.
Never.
Yeah. Bring that amp. He brought that amp right there, put it in the front yard, and just started playing.
Never. Never look at the audience. Always look at your neck.
That's funny.
And he was playing this one to the chick.
That's funny.
Sorry. Go ahead.
Actually, there was one time.
There it is.
There was one time. Okay. This is back in high school. I think I was a junior in high school. And I had that high school crush on this girl. So I wrote this song for a talent show.
What's her name?
I can't tell you that.
What's her initials?
M-E.
Uh-oh.
Maria.
Elliot. I was going to say Missy Elliott.
Missy Elliott? It was Missy Elliott. So I actually sang into a mic, and I played this song I wrote for her.
Maria?
And she didn't show up.
Oh, that's horrible.
Ripped out your heart and stepped on it.
Oh, yeah. It was just, oh, my God.
But you played it even harder, I bet.
Oh, well, I turned it into a freaking angry grunge version of it.
Well, you can't see out in the crowd,
true,
you know,
true.
I mean, you got the lights down on you. I mean, everything, so you can't really see out there. So I thought she was there, but apparently she wasn't. I go walking backstage and go to where all the musicians were, and if you want to call us that back then in high school.
Yeah.
She said, "Oh, I missed it." I'm like, "You did what?"
Nowadays, you miss it. Just go on YouTube and watch it. Back then, it's like you miss it. It's done.
It's done. That's it.
That's crazy. That's funny.
That's horrible.
Well, M.A., if you're out there, he did it. He did it for you, and you didn't show.
Oh, man. Cindy.
Let's see. If you could tour with any famous band, past or present, who would you pick?
Ooh.
Ooh, that's a good one. Oh, my gosh.
I'm sure he has stories on these.
I'd love to tour with Neil Schon and Journey. That'd be awesome. Genesis.
Okay.
Phil Collins,
Mike Rutherford, Tony Banks.
Yeah, those guys are awesome. I heard Phil Collins retired because he has some type of, like, hand issue.
Tendonitis?
Something where he can't really perform. Did you hear about that?
I did not, but I noticed that he's just totally out of scene. He's not even doing scores for Disney anymore.
Yeah, so...
That's really devastating, though, when you play an instrument for so long. I mean, I've known a lot of students and teachers that this has happened to, and... It is really, really devastating.
It is. It's your livelihood.
Take your vitamins, kids.
And learn to stretch.
For
stretching exercises.
Yeah, stretching exercises.
There you go. So, Journey, Genesis, who else?
I think Crosby, Stills, and Nash.
Wow.
And
going back.
That'd be really cool. And then... I think hanging out with the Eagles and Jackson Browne and Bonnie Raitt back in the day, I think that would be like an epic time to be in L.A.
Yeah.
It probably
you know
was.
What I mean? Don Felder, all of that, because they're writing wonderful music back then.
Mm-hmm.
And still today. I mean, you hear it, and some of it's overplayed, but you get on some of those B-side songs and stuff like that, and it's like, wow, they really put their heart and their energy behind it, and just a history of how they all... grew up in L.A.
Mm-hmm.
Would you wear your spandex pants?
Of course.
Yes.
And they were red, by the way.
Red!
Wow.
And I had the black tight body shirt. And
was it turquoise?
Black.
No, it was black. Black and red.
No, did you have any turquoise?
Oh, jewelry, like turquoise.
Oh,
jewelry.
Turquoise jewelry?
Oh, was that bigger then?
No, actually, I did silver.
Silver.
Yeah. It was silver. No turquoise.
These freaking colors are crazy.
Did you wear the eyeliner and stuff?
On one show.
We got to see those photos. We have to.
You know what? I'll dig them up, and they're in a photo album, and I'll send them to you.
All right.
But I've got some other ones that I'll email you on break. And
perfect.
You can post them up.
Perfect. Now, let's go ahead and fast forward to the Floor Shakers. How did that whole concept come together? How'd you get the name Floor Shakers?
Let's see. Well, so after I got my life together.
It's a good way to start sentence.
Yeah.
AKA I got off heavy drugs.
Yeah. And so in 2002, I wanted to start playing again because all I was doing was a bunch of studio recordings, just kind of.
Fucking around.
Yeah, goofing around. And. So I auditioned for every band in Contra Costa County. And
Including the PhDs?
No, not the PhDs. They already had a guitar player. Bobby, you're fantastic, by the way. And so I went to this, a friend of ours, Dan D'Souza, would do this thing called Bud Fest out in Clayton in the back of his house. And he would invite all of his musician friends there to perform.
That must be an awfully big house.
It was huge, beautiful house, swimming pool. He had a stage behind the pool, and everybody would show up, and you know, all kinds of music would play during the day.
You said it was Bud Fest?
Yeah, it was called Bud Fest.
Is it still happening now?
Actually, yes.
Wow.
Yeah, he still has the Bud Fest, but his band is the only band that plays now. Sorry, Dan.
We got to go crash that. Sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, it is a lot of fun. And so everybody showed up with a band, and I'm like, well, I don't have a band. What am I going to do? So I went in the studio. I recorded a bunch of backing tracks, and I went out there with my CD player. Not my 8-track.
Okay, CDs now.
Okay,
CDs.
We've upgraded.
Yes.
All right.
We're in the- and so this guy, Pops, is all, where's your band? I said, right here in this box. I got a band in a box. And so he plugged that in. And so they played the backing tracks and they did a solo over it. And a gentleman named John Sino and Mark Ventris had just started a band, and I've never met him before, but when I came off stage, John came up to me, and he's all, are you in a band? I said, no, I'm not. He goes, why don't you come out and come jam with me? And my guy's out in Pittsburgh. And I'm like, yeah, okay, yeah, I'll check it out. So he handed me his card, and then John's band went up and played. And John Sino is a phenomenal singer. For those of you who don't know who John Sino is, he started singing for...
He owns all the housing and real estate projects out here.
I'm not sure what part of the Sino family he is. There's double I's and double E's.
Okay.
Okay.
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Right.
Owns practically all of Contra Costa, property-wise.
So he sang, and I'm like, oh, my God, this guy is fantastic. So I took his card, and then I lost it for like 2 months. And so I was up in my studio, and I'm cleaning up. I'm like, bam, here's the card. And, and I call over there and go, hey, you still looking for a guitar player in John's Hall?
After 2 months.
Yeah, after 2 months, he goes, yeah, we're still looking for a guitar player. We thought you didn't want to jam with us. So, yeah,
because a lot could happen in 2 months.
Yeah, a lot can happen. And they went through a bunch of guitar players. And so I show up there, and they gave me a set list of songs to go over with. And normally auditions take, you know, 5-10 minutes, right? You pretty much know whether the guy's going to be a good fit or not.
Right.
So 45 minutes into this audition, I just stop, and I'm all, hey, so what's up? Am I in the band? Right? And John's all, well, we thought, you know, because you wanted us to join you. I said, no, we'll get together. So so that's where we took, but we didn't have a name back then.
Okay.
So we did all these songs, all these cover songs and stuff like that, and I never played any cover music until 2002 when I met these guys.
Gotcha.
So it was a whole new world for me, a whole new learning techniques and phrasing and everything. So I was just totally gung-ho about it.
Mm-hmm.
So we're doing this private party, and a good friend of mine, Joe Arnadon, who works with Jay, I'll never forget the name of the sound company, he got all this recording gear, and he put it in his girlfriend's garage, and they did this live recording of the band. And we were just doing a house party. And we couldn't come up with the name of the band, and we were recording and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody yelled out, free beer.
Free beer.
Not free bird, but free beer.
Yeah.
So for the first 9 months of what was now the floor, or going to be the Floor Shakers, we were called, actually, free beer.
Free beer. That's funny.
So you'd imagine the disappointment on people's faces when they walk into a bar after they see a sign that says free beer tonight.
Right.
Yeah.
It's beer called, beer here.
Yeah.
Free beer tonight.
You know, prodigize, you know, your band. And we were a five-piece back then.
Okay.
And so we had a great time for that year. And
then you got sued for using a free beer.
Yeah, right? Pretty
got
much.
Got this letter, cease and desist.
Cease and desist.
Did you really?
No.
Sound pretty believable, though.
Yeah, pretty good. I got to use that one.
Thank you.
Like in the Blues Brothers.
So after that, we started getting a bunch of gigs. And we, you know, we just didn't, you know, free beer just didn't fit us anymore. So we're
thinking of all like it. You're going to do a children's party. It's like, oh, ladies and gentlemen, free beer. It's like, okay. Got a little bunch of 10-year-olds there.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so we were sitting in Mark Ventris's house out in Pittsburgh, out here.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, we just started going, running over these names, and there was a band called the Bone Shakers and this and that and whatever, and also we said, Floor Shakers! Great! So that was the name, and that's how we came up with it.
Mm.
And, you know, I kind of like free beer, but yeah. That was a better story of how the name came, but the Floor Shakers, we just kind of sat around the table. And
just rotate.
Brainstorm. Yeah.
This gig will be called Free Beer.
Yeah. Beer Shakers!
Beer Shakers.
So... After that, we went about, I think, 2 years, and we were playing everywhere.
That's awesome.
As a five piece, and then but John and I, we always wanted to have a huge band.
Yeah.
With full horns and multiple singers and
tuba player.
And tuba player. And so we decided to go that route.
Yeah.
And when we took it to the band, who didn't take it very lightly.
Yeah. They're like, oh, you're going to bring in someone that's taking out my cut.
Yeah. Then we figured, well, who are we going to get? And John goes, well, I know a bunch of guys from Pittsburgh that'll come out. And so he called them up, mm-hmm. and they literally had to take their horns out of the attic and blow the dust off the cases, right, to come in there. And so John recruited Dave Arms, Gino Archimedi, Rudy Vera, and that was our first horn section.
Mm.
Then Lou Esposito came in,
yes.
and he was our percussionist, singer, all-around good guy. And then John had met, because we wanted to keep doing rock, but we wanted to do the dance band, cover band thing.
Mark and Mark and all that shit, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Good vibrations.
Yeah. So we had this idea of taking a three-piece rock band and mixing it with the horn section,
mm-hmm.
and then John and I putting all the glue together.
Yeah.
And so John had found this three-piece band, Mike DeFrancesco, he was on drums, David Lopez was on bass, and I forget what the other guitar player was. Really talented guy. Just forget his name. And so we put it together, and that was the original Floor Shaker band at that point.
That was an eight-piece band at that point, right?
One, two, three, four. I think we're nine.
Okay.
Yeah, no, eight. And then as that progressed, all of a sudden, we just exploded. We were the highest paid Delta band. We were playing all the Delta Coves and everything.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
We were playing here in Humphreys. We were doing the Seafood Festival. We were
blowing up.
We were blowing up. We were the first band at this Pittsburgh Seafood Festival to play both stages, both days of the Seafood Festival. We were headlining everywhere we went. It was just fantastic. For like 8 years.
That's awesome.
Just awesome. Photos and everything.
You're rock stars.
Yeah. I mean, just you know.
You're like, no makeup, and I'm getting love.
Right. Yeah, no spandex.
Oh, what a second of that Pittsburgh weather.
Yeah. And I didn't know at the time how much talent was in the city of Pittsburgh. I mean, Pittsburgh just bleeds talent.
I agree. I agree.
Musicians, actors, everything. Mm-hmm. It's just incredible. And I was, you know, I wasn't from around here, but they all took me in, and I got to meet everybody. Gerald Glasper, the PhDs, Leo Vigil, Amador Miro.
Let everyone know what PhD stands for.
Pittsburgh High School
Go dropouts. Ahead. Yeah, that's right.
Right? That's my dropout. I was going to say, pulse tool digger?
That's the PhDs for you.
And Mundi. Mundi was a character.
Mundi Orozco.
Yeah, Mundi. And when we first started out, we had so much gear.
I can imagine.
It was incredible.
Did you have like 20 cars having one piece, two pieces in?
Our first PA actually fit with all my guitars and everything in the back of my Ford Expedition. We crammed everything in that thing. And
you didn't bust any windows or anything?
Just about. And it was so much funnier than Gino talked to Mundi. And I don't think the PhDs were doing that much back then at that time.
They're just well-known.
Yeah, they're well-known. And then Mundi offered up, hey, you know, you could use our trailer for a little while. So I said, okay, picked up the trailer, and it said PhDs on it and stuff like that, but it was all good. But, you know, they loaned us the trailer.
That's nice of him to do that.
Yeah, and, it was a great time to be in music because it was old school time. Music gets so competitive at all levels. And being an old school player and meeting other old school players, mm-hmm. you know, if you couldn't cover a show, you would call up your buddy who was in a band. Hey, can you cover this because of that? And there was no discrepancies or anything that you're going to steal the gig. It was just, you know, people would just say, hey, you know, and that's the way music was.
Sharing is caring.
Yeah. And that's the way that I was, you know, brought up in music. Hey, you know, if you can't cover the gig, well, you know, let's bring this band in and we'll do this show and I'll be over here. And everybody helped everybody. And that's what I really loved about the Pittsburgh community is that I saw that and I was like, wow, what a great family to be in. These people are just wonderful. And, you know, we made a bunch of mistakes along the way, but all was forgiven. I mean, you got to take your knocks with all the good and the bad.
Exactly. Comes with the territory.
Yeah.
Now, as far as these gigs, what was the... we usually ask, like, what's your best gig and what's your worst gig? But I'm just going to put a little twist on it. How about the furthest gig you guys had to travel to and had to basically room, have to deal with each other for that road trip? Did you ever experience that?
No, actually, we never...
So it's always been here in the Contra Costa area?
Yeah, it's always been close or drivable.
Okay.
Yeah, we...
Have you ever gotten inquiries on that? Like, hey, can you do... a gig over in LA or
but it was just a lot of wind.
Okay.
Promoters saying, oh, well, I can do this and here's my card and call me, I'll set you up. I mean, you get a lot of that. Mm-hmm. But no, we did everything locally and we got a big following and we were happy.
Cool.
I mean, it was, and that's what music needs to be. You got to be happy when you're playing music. You got to be happy with the people you're on stage with.
Exactly. You don't want to be angry. Oh, I want to be with this motherfucker. Yeah. Fuck that.
Right. Or looking like Twisted Sister and stuff.
Quiet Riot.
Right. There you go. So it was just a beautiful time. And especially for me, because I was learning a whole new genre of music. I'm still learning a whole new genre of music.
Yeah.
With the funk and the soul and the R&B, it's hard to transition being a rock guitar player into R&B and into funk, especially funk, because the rhythms are so different and you're
just used to rocking out, just blow
right, and the sound levels are so high playing rock and roll.
Yeah,
and you got these big Marshall stacks behind you.
Yeah, that's why you're saying, Sam, can you please turn up my guitar? I'm like, damn, dude, it's already fucking loud. Right.
Right. And you know, and then you're showing it to the gig with a little amp like this. It's like, really? Are you sure this is gonna work? You know, you can turn it up a little bit. So it's a big adjustment. It's still a real big adjustment because when John Cena, when he decided to leave the band and go to the band Evolution, that was that took a lot of wind out of my sail.
Yeah, because you're now the main guy.
Exactly.
There's no co-leader anymore.
Are you singing or no?
No, I'm not singing, and there's a good reason why.
Fair enough.
So we the band got together. and we figured out what we wanted to do, and I just kind of took the reins by it. I guess it's my type A personality or something. I said, okay, well, we'll just make it work.
Right.
And I had no idea of what I was doing at all. Just like, okay, I'll be the band leader. Sign me up. Ding, ding, you know. And so Gino and Rudy, and I think even Dave Arms, they recruited Gerald Glasper.
Mm-hmm.
Great, great entertainer. And he came in and filled the shoes for John Cena. And then we were still missing a little bit, so we went out and got another singer, mm-hmm. Jimmy Martin, and he was singing with Gerald for a while, and that worked out okay for the time being. Jimmy wanted to pursue some other things, and then Gerald took the reins and then performed for us for about 3-4 years.
You got good use out of him.
Yeah, and you know, Gerald taught us all about entertainment. I used to confide a lot to Gerald about certain things that were going on,
mm-hmm.
that I didn't really understand about music and stuff like that. So he was a good guiding light for me, but you know, the band still needed to grow, and so we decided to go with a 4 lead singer front.
That's a lot.
Yeah, 2 female singers and 2 male leads. So at that time, we were auditioning and auditioning for male singers and just couldn't find the right fit.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked John to come back. John came back for a few shows with Gerald, and the vocals were amazing. We auditioned Michelle Full, who was our first female lead vocalist. And I videotaped everything.
Mm-hmm.
And my daughter and I are watching these videos. And I think there was 15 or 20 lead singers that wanted the position. So I'm running the video. And Dad's all, stop. Or Kyla's all, stop. Dad,
this is on right VHS, there. Right?
Yeah. And she goes, that's her right there. And I'm like... Yeah. And then she sang. I said, really? That's her? She goes, yeah, that's her. Mm. I said, okay.
Daughter knows best.
Yeah. And so I called her up, and Michelle sang for us for about 3-4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then she brought in Tempe Managa. They sang together in an a cappella group at UC Berkeley called the Golden Overtones. Tempe is still with the band. She's
She was the one over on stage with.
Yes.
Him. Yeah.
Yeah. She's still with the band, and she helps me out. She's my right hand person for all the weddings and private events and everything, and the vocals, and organizing everything. What I did learn how to do was to delegate roles,
mm-hmm.
in a band, because when you have a band that's so large, with all the different egos and schedules, that it's a dance to try and get everybody to rehearsal, to try and get everybody,
I can imagine,
for photographs, to get everybody to do anything, you know, show up for sound check for weddings,
because you're basically the dad and all these are your kids.
Yeah. And you spend more time with the band than you do with your family a lot of times, you know, even entertainers.
Yeah.
I mean, right, because you're going to be going everywhere, right, Joe,
with yes, sir.
And everything. So
that's why he's a single guy.
Yeah.
No attachments. Nothing. He's good to go,
right,
ladies and gentlemen.
Right.
Wherever you want me, I'm there.
So so that was a lot to learn,
mm-hmm.
about just dealing with people in general.
Yeah.
I'm still learning how to do it.
Yeah.
it's very tough. And, you know, you try and get people to understand, well, my position, but a lot of times it gets blocked because you don't see the other person's position.
Mm-hmm.
You're just trying, well, I'm getting the gigs, I'm doing this, we got to do that, I got to get the sound here. And it just rolls, that domino that people... But what you get blindsided in is that, you know, you have people in the band that have certain needs, and you, I try to
accommodate
yeah. the best I can.
I want my Frappuccino exactly like this, or else I'm going to get moody.
I think of all the orchestra friends I've had, I think the personnel manager was one of the most stressful, horrific, nightmarish, aggravated kinds of jobs that I've been witness to.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'll hear one of them like, half my violins quit, and goes and slams the office door because he needs to get on the phone and he needs to remedy that before a concert that week. And,
right.
And it's, no, that's not an easy job. Mm-hmm. That's not an easy job.
Yeah. And then, you know, the other thing that comes with the job is that everybody in the band has a different project or something going on. So the outside scheduling with what the Floor Shakers do and what they do on their own personal music time,
mm-hmm.
you know, sometimes they can't make the gig. And then we had to bring our subs in. And thank God for subs. I've met some great musicians along the way, and just from the band saying, oh, well, I know the guy that can come fill in for me. So we still have that old school tendency.
Yeah, that structure.
Yeah, which is a really, really good thing to have inside a band. So for any of you kids listening out there, you know, have that old school pride and help each other out.
They're like, what the hell is old school?
Yeah, exactly.
I want my Justin Bieber track.
Yeah.
Now,
$100.
Well, let's go ahead and start closing out the questions. Yeah. You have a little story to tell about one of the band members of the Floor Shakers kind of getting a little bit out of whack.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Yeah.
There we were, New Year's Eve.
Now, was this an early Floor Shakers assembly or later on, current?
This is...
because we want to kind of put in that accurate pocket of time frame.
Okay. This was 6 years ago.
He knows it, ladies
and gentlemen. It was New Year's Eve night. San Ramon Marriott.
I thought you were going to say Wild Idol and Byron.
We played there before.
Yeah, I'm going to play there at the end of the month.
Yeah, it's fun. Agnes is great.
Yeah.
Brass stripper pole.
Yeah, right in the middle of the stage.
I have pictures on said pole.
So,
that's fun.
So we just finished the balloon drop.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so we just came off break and we celebrated and...
Everyone's drinking.
Everybody's drinking, having a good time.
Yeah.
And we're playing Give It To Me, Baby.
Yeah.
Right? Do, 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 do.
Rick James.
And then they have like this keyboard thing, thing. And also we hear this. I'm standing there with Gino and Dave Lopez, bass player. Gino's on sax. And we're just kind of also we hear this clank, 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 clank. And we're like, oh my God, what the heck is that? And we're playing. All of a sudden, the rest of the band is hearing it. It's like clank, 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 clank. We look over, and our keyboard player is passed out. And he just went, right? And he was hitting. And I think Gabe was our sound guy.
Gabe's in the chat room right now.
And he killed the keyboard. I think he was working with Bill McCullough at the time. And they killed the keyboard section. And then we went over there because we woke Jim up because he was just passed out. Did I say his name? I did, huh?
You did. Fuck it.
I didn't say his last name.
Could be any Jim.
Yeah. And so anyways, yeah.
Did he come to, or was he just out of it? Someone freaking
came,
put a roofie in his drink or something.
He came out of it for the next song after that. But still, it was just that. I'll always remember it. It was like, clank, 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 clank. It's like, oh, my God. Now,
so that was him just stumbling on top of the keyboard, him trying to play in this, like, drunken stupor.
Yeah, he was just trying to play and... Well, you know, I got 166 keys here now. It was 88 when I started.
That's crazy.
Pick the middle one.
Yeah,
pick the middle one.
So, that was our New Year's Eve story.
That's crazy.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
Yeah, well, so don't drink and play keyboards.
Oh wow.
So Doug, let's talk about the upcoming public appearances one more time as we close this out.
Oh, okay. Let's see. We are Public appearance is July 7th.
Yeah.
Arinda Summer Concert Series.
And well, we could always have the public crash some private events if you like them.
Oh,
too.
Yeah. Please do. Please do. They're all weddings. They're all weddings. Gotta love it. So we'll do the Arinda Summer Concert Series, which is July 7th from 6 to 8:30, I do believe. And then we are at the Gilroy Garlic Festival.
In Gilroy.
On the main stage from 3, they're only giving us a 45-minute set, so 3 to 3:45.
That's it?
Yeah, the Gilroy Garlic Festival is going to have twice as much entertainment as they did last year.
Who's headlining?
I wish we were.
I know. The Floor Shaker.
I'm not sure who it is. I have to look at the final schedule.
It's Journey.
Oh, my God. That'd be great. But they're only getting 45 minutes. I'm only getting 45 minutes.
And getting paid like 10 times more.
Right. Exactly.
How unfair.
Yes. But he's the lead singer's Filipino, so.
Exactly.
And then we are doing the Oakley Summer Concert Series in Oakley on Main Street. They have a brand new amphitheater that they just built. I think about a year and a half old now. So come on out to that. That is August 8th from 6 to 8:30. That'll be a great show. And I think that's it for our public engagements because everything else is private events and weddings.
And what is the website that people could follow you at?
That is www.thefloorshakers.com.
I like how you pointed onto your headphone and went into the radio voice.
Right, there you go.
Cool, cool. Yep. All right. Let's go ahead and close out the program with our shouts and plugs because we are going to have you play into the end of the show.
Oh, great.
Yeah. Just like they do on the freaking talk shows on midnight, late night stuff.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, so love we're going to do it in style. Joe Time, take it away.
Yeah, just shout out to everybody that's been tuning in and keep tuning in. We got a lot of things coming your way. It's pretty awesome. Thank you, Slam and Sam, and just everybody in the audience today. Sid and dude, I just love the way you play guitar, man. You made love to that thing, bro. It was awesome. He was just jamming. I was just at awe. And I can't wait to see you pick that up again. And yeah, I definitely want to check out one of your local events. Hopefully the one in Oakley sounds a little bit more sound for me.
That'll be fun.
Gilroy Garlic, you know? We'll see. But Oakley, I got to check out the amphitheater. I didn't know that existed.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Either that or the Wild Idol, you know?
Agnes, we need to get booked at the Wild Idol.
Yeah, and just all the other co-hosts, man. Arlene, feel better soon. And Sage, Mike Ill, you know, Lena Rowe, all you guys. And then if you guys want to catch me, go ahead and see me at Instagram, Joe_Time. Facebook, that's / Joe Time Comedy on Facebook. And yeah, so June 30th, I'll be at Tommy T's. I'll be headlining that one. Also, June 28th, I believe, I'll be at Cobb's in San Francisco. And yeah, September 5th, remember that date. That's when I'll be shooting my hour special. So yeah, stay tuned. Just keep following. You'll see some great stuff coming your way. Thank you.
Cool, cool. Cindy.
All right. Doug, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you, crew. Thank you, listeners. Congratulations again to Julie on your graduation. And thank you, Mom and Dad. I will be there to pick up my bad dog shortly.
All right. Doug, take it away. Your shouts and plugs.
Oh, my
shouts. Yeah. Before you go into the
I'm out of here.
Not yet. Not quite yet.
Oh, well, thank you, everybody, for having me. It's been a pleasure. Joe.
Of course.
Cindy. Slam and Sam. I hope we get to hook up and put that five-piece band together.
Yes.
The DJ and everything.
Yeah.
It'll be great.
Yeah. That's what we're going
to
do.
Yeah. So come out and see some of our live shows. If you want to book us, www.thefloorshakers.com. You can check out our Facebook page, which is Fans of the Floor Shakers. We'll have all our updated shows and all the information that you need to know on both of those sites. And everybody have a great evening. Have fun. Thank you.
Cool, cool. All right, I'll go ahead and close out the shouts and plugs. As usual, I'd like to thank my entire crew, Cindy, Joe, as always, great job. Our special guest, Doug from the Floor Shakers. It's been a pleasure having you on the program. And go ahead and start prepping up. As you're going to close out with this one track, the ballad, as we...
Is this the one with the talent show?
And I'd like to thank everyone that's in the chat room enjoying the program, interacting with us, and everyone that's watching anonymously. Continue to support the Slam Show. We'll keep bringing you credible guests and good content that you guys will always talk about for years to come. All right, guys, we're going to go ahead and close out the show with a solo performance. Doug from the Floor Shakers here on the Slam Show. We'll see you next week.
Adios.
Peace.
Mm-hmm.